Hey everyone, Matt Donner here from Pyramind. As part of our guitar month, I've decided to share something with you that I run into a lot when it comes to guitars. You can apply this principle to something other than guitars, but for today we're going to do it on guitars. It's an EQ principle more than anything else, and it's what I call the four dogs of rock and roll. And they are growl, roar, bark, and bite. And just by the sound of the names, you can kind of get a sense as to where I'm going to go. This is a case where you either have a single guitar or a group of guitars. Today, what I have is a premix of several guitar takes in one. The situation is the client sends you something and says, here's my track, here's my guitar part. It's kind of a mess. What can you do? Can you help me? I don't know what I'm doing. Do you have the original guitars? No, of course not. All I have is the bounce. So I threw in some drums from the original session, and I also have the guitars from the session. What we're going to do is we're going to apply the four dog principle in two different ways. One is we're going to frequency section them off into the four slots as four different tracks, show you what's good and bad about that way. And then the other is if you are feeling lazy or just don't have the time, you can get it all done with a single tool. I'm using Logic today, and in Logic the other tool is the multipressor. Some of you may or may not have seen a tip from me earlier on YouTube comparing and contrasting different ways to use the multiband compression tool. If you have, this could be a great follow-up for you. If you haven't, it's on our channel. Go check it out. So let me introduce you to the dogs. Here we go. First thing what I'm going to do is, I guess what I'll do first is I will mute everything and I'll just play the original track without the multipressor here. You can see I've got it deactivated. And just to give you a quick tour of the session, it's pretty much drums from here to here. These are live drums that were recorded in another studio, and they were done to this guitar part, so they should be pretty close. And then we're going to basically spend our time comparing and contrasting this channel with the multipressor. And that's this guy here. You can see I've got some pre-baked settings already in there, and I'll walk you through those. So we're going to compare that to this guy. And this guy is actually a track stack. So it is four different tracks. You can see they're aptly labeled growl, roar. Well, that's this one over here. Over here. You. Thank you. Bark and bite. And as you can see, they have different EQ settings. And that's pretty much it. So one of the main differences between the two dog techniques, one being purely EQ and another being a combination of EQ and compression, or at least a single tool that is a compressor that acts like an EQ the way I'm using it. Again, advantages, disadvantages, I'll leave it to you to decide which one you like better. So here we go. Let's dig in. Let's start on the original and let me introduce you to the part. And it's a whole song, about 3.5 minutes. I won't play the whole thing for you. I'll just play a little bit so you can at least get a sense of what's going on. Okay, that's just the intro, obviously. It's a few different guitar takes in one piece of audio here, and it's a little hard to tell now because they were played really tightly, but I think if I play from over here, you'll start hearing a little as sort of take one was a little early, take two was a little late. They'll kind of fly like this, and then they'll jump together and they'll stay together, just so you can hear that there are indeed multiple takes in one part here. Here for that first couple of clicks, click, 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 bum, 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 and then they go in sync. If this were ready to go out, first thing I would do would be to edit that tight and see if I can fix that problem. But really, I'm just using it to show you that there are multiple guitar parts in this one piece of audio. Now, it doesn't sound bad. Sounds actually pretty solid. But if we were to mute the other part here and then open up it against the drums, you might find that it's not necessarily standing up. can hear everything. It's all there. The guitar's there. It doesn't have a lot of power, but it certainly has tone. And so the idea is I want to kind of juice the guitar. I want to give it more, you know, teeth. Dogs, guitar, teeth, you know, they go together. Nice. You're going to make this face when you're doing it. So I want to give the guitar part a little bit more teeth. And in this case, I'm going to start with the first technique, which is to just say, you know what, I'm going to put a multiband on it. You could do this with a single EQ. You can kind of do this other technique with a single EQ, but there are disadvantages to doing that. And it's actually the same disadvantage to using the multipressor technique, which is that you're stuck with the original audio as is. I'm a big fan when mixing, if you don't have all of the sounds that you want and you can't go back and get more parts, you have to take the part you have and sort of copy it, alter it, copy it, and now you have varieties of the parts that you can play with. That's technique two. What I'm going to do here is technique one, which is to just simply use a multipressor, see if I can pull up some character out of the guitar. So first things first, let's solo it. And for those who don't know the multipressor or multiband compression, it's faster for you to go watch the other video I've done on our channel. Go do that. The short version is it slices a sound into multiple frequency slivers or columns, and then you can boost or cut them independently. You can solo them, mute them, compress them individually within a frequency band. So you can take the bass, the low mid, the high, and treat them as four different parts. With four different compression settings and four different gain settings. And that's kind of what I've done here. These guitars have been run through amps and amp simulators. There's not a lot necessary in terms of dynamics. I have a little bit of dynamic going on just to give you a sense. If I hit play and you watch the meters, you'll see the threshold looks like it's really low, but according to the meters, it's not. And I don't have ratios. Some of them are 1.3, 2.2, 2.3, 1.8. So they're fairly low ratios. Now with a really low threshold, a low ratio still does some work. And you'll see the gain reduction meter pumping here. So first things first, I'll just do kind of an on-off, and then I'll show you each of the bands. So here's without. Okay, so as you can hear, a lot of the mid-range character, a lot of the teeth start showing up here. I am pulling down some of the low end, definitely boosting the low mid, the mids and the highs, low mid, high mid, number three, the high mid is getting a little bit more of a boost here. And just to give you an idea, the reason why is that this is my growl, this is my roar, this is my bark, and this is my bite. And it's literally growl, roar, bark, and bite. And so they're gonna be the vocal sounds that I'm making match the words, match the frequency tones. Soloing them through, here is that's the growl. As you can see, I'm compressing it. It's actually compressing a little bit much, so I'll lighten that up a little bit. And then that's the tone. It's a deep, deep kind of a sound. If I were miking this amp, this would probably be the sound that I would try to capture with a mic at the back of an amp. A lot of times with amps, I'll put a couple on front, a couple a little bit off from the amp, 3 or 4 feet, and then I'll stick one in back of the amp, flip the phase. There's usually a ton of low end at the back of a cabinet of an amp. Remember, the speaker's pushing out all that treble, and when it's coming back in, it's pushing treble and bass out, but there's a lot of phase inverted sound there. A lot of the high end disappears because there's no directionality behind the speaker, but there's a ton of bass, which is omnidirectional. So this is kind of mimicking the sound of a mic at the back of an amp. So that's this one. Here's the roar. If I give it a little bump so you can really hear it. It's a really satisfying tone. I sort of liken this to the sound of a Buell motorcycle. It's got a really nice deep resonance. It's not bass, it's kind of above that. It's, you know, second, third harmonic territory, but it's got a nice warmth in the guitar tone, leaves room for a thuddy kick, leaves room for a nice thick bass underneath it. There's another reason why I turned this down. There's a lot of low end in the kick drum, so I might want to pull some of the low end out of the guitar, make some room for the kick. Moving on to Mr. Bark. As you can hear, that's got a lot of the real high vocal texture. This guitar part is tuned down, so the guitar naturally gives a lot of ninth chords, first 1, 5, and 9. I think it's in the key of C sharp, so it would be C sharp, G sharp, and then not C sharp, the octave, but D sharp, one above that. So that's a 1, 5, 9 triad of sorts. It's not really a triad, it doesn't have a third, but call them a three note cluster, spread over an octave. It's a really cool sound. I happen to like it. And there's a lot of those 5 and 9 tones that are going to be found here. You're going to find a lot of the fundamentals here. But then here you're going to get the octave. It's really up here. That ninth is really, it gets picked up here, and that's part of the iconic nature of the part. So I'm really just focusing, well, the wide focus, but I'm focusing a little bit on those tones. Moving on to the bite. As you can hear, it's a lot of the high, squeaky, scrackly, scratchy, crackly, scratchy sounds, pick on string sounds. I do try to avoid my friend here, 3.3K, which is the crossover point here. So I'm kind of boosting up to that and then pulling down a little bit from that. 3.2, 3.3 has a tendency to get a little harsh on my ear. So I like to set the crossover point there. For some reason, it helps me not accentuate that tone very much. So all of that said, here, let me go back to the beginning. Here are your four dogs. So as you can hear, there's just a ton more life, a ton more detail, a ton more energy. The teeth are starting to show in the guitar. It's nice. And if I were to put this up against the drums before and after, it'll give you another sense as to how it kind of just steps up, takes a little bit more presence in the mix. Back to the beginning here. Pretty obvious it's much better this way. Now, advantage to doing this is you can at any time alter this balance. So I find that now there's a nice energy of the guitars. They're kind of where the guitar was sitting quieter than the drums. Now they're sitting a little bit louder than the drums, which for rock I think is appropriate. We got a nice detailed view of the kick drum, and I don't want to lose that, but I might want to get a little bit more growl out of the dog here. So I'm just going to turn up this band, and you watch. I'm just going to play with these and see what result comes up. See if there's a mix that kind of helps make room for the snare. Maybe I start blocking the snare with the guitar, get a little bit more power. Maybe I just took the bass down, make more room for the kick. You have some options here. We'll be right back. little crazy in there with the bass sometimes. So, you know, you have a lot of control, which is cool. You can turn, I kind of liked it when it was down here. It sort of had a nice 90s Smashing Pumpkins scoopy sound. Sounds like somebody threw a 57 on a Marshall stack, and this is not a Marshall stack. This is a guitar and a bunch of amp simulators. So now all of a sudden you have some timbral shaping that you can do. Now that's great. You have some options, you have some control. What you don't have is pan control. It still sounds like one part, even though it's multiple guitars making the one audio, it still sounds like it's one thing and it's in one position. So, we're gonna go on to technique number two.